Hello, I'm Mudabbir Qureshi. Today I am again with you. Today I will make you explain what's natural selection and how does natural selection occur in the nature. You all have gone through the Darwinian concept or the Darwin's theory of the natural selection. What Darwin believed basically is that only those individuals will survive which are fittest in their environment. Darwin already explained the concept of the competition. He believed that always there is competition among the organisms for the resources, and those organisms which compete fully in the what we call as the competition, either intraspecific, extraspecific, or interspecific, and those individuals who survive the competition, they emerge out as the successful ones, and these individuals do have useful variations, and these are the individuals which will survive the competition. And this is what Darwin called as natural selection. Darwin believed that only those individuals will survive which do have an adaptive advantage or which do have useful variations so that they can better adjust in their environment and they can better compete their competition. This is what Darwin called as the natural selection. What Darwin called as the natural selection, what we call as Spinks are called it as the survival of the fittest. So what is natural selection to the Darwin is a survival of fittest to the Spinks. Both convey the same meanings. But once the fields of the population genetics and the molecular genetics they came to the limelight, the concepts of the natural selection totally changed. As you see, once the genetics came into limelight, or once the concepts of genetics, particularly population genetics, came to the forefront, the whole concept of the Darwinian theory changed. Although Darwinian theory is not any such theory that we may discard it totally, but there were many alterations which were done in the Darwinian theory in respect of the modern science of the genetics. So this concept of natural selection also was redefined by using the science of the genetics. So what to the modern these geneticists and modern evolutionists, to them, what is the natural selection? It is basically the differential reproduction. The modern geneticists believe that it is basically the differential reproduction, what Darwin called as the natural selection. For example, we see that in the Darwinian theory, Darwin believed that all those individuals which survive the competition, and only these individuals will what we call as survive, and they are the fittest ones. But modern synthetic theory analyzes the things in a different way. It believes that those individuals which survive the competition, only these individuals will reproduce, whereas those individuals which failed in the competition, they will undergo genetic death, means they will not reproduce as such, their genes will not be represented in the next generation. So there are only those individuals which survive the competition whose genes will be represented in the next generation. So in a nutshell, we say that there is difference in the reproduction, as only those individuals which survive the competition have the chance of representing their genes in the upcoming generations, and all those who do not survive the competition, all those individuals who do not survive the competition, they vanish, they undergo genetic death, and they have no representation of their genes in the upcoming generation. So this is how a modern synthetic theory analyzes the things in a different way than that of the Darwinian concept. So we say, as per the modern synthetic theory, the natural selection is simply a process of differential reproduction in which those individuals which have survived the competition, they have more chances of the reproduction and more chances of propagating their alleles and genes in the upcoming generations. Whereas all those who do not survive the competition and undergo genetic death, they don't have any chance of representing their genes in the upcoming generations. So all this happens, and in upcoming generations, we see those individuals which have or had an adaptive advantage, means which were the survivors in the competition, their allelic frequency will increase in the upcoming generations or in the gene pool of the upcoming generations. Whereas all those individuals whose what we call as all those individuals who failed in the competition or who didn't survive the competition, their genes will not be represented in the upcoming generations or in the upcoming offsprings. As a result, the allelic frequency of these genes will decrease in the upcoming generations. So those genes which had an adaptive advantage, they will have more representation in the upcoming generations, and all those genes which do not have an adaptive advantage will have very less representation or no representation in the gene pool of the upcoming generations and upcoming populations. So this is the way we look upon the concept of the natural selection by using the science of population genetics and the molecular genetics. So as already said in the earlier lecture, the concepts of the evolution or the definitions of evolution have also changed from the Darwinian concept to the modern synthetic theory. In the this Darwin in the Darwinian concept, we believe that natural selection, we believe that evolution is simply the descent with modification. But once we see the molecular and population genetics, we see that evolution is basically changing allelic and gene frequencies in the gene pools of the populations. So have the concepts of the natural selection changed by incorporating the science of the genetics in the evolutionary biology. So this is what we call as the natural selection. So natural selection is simply the survival of the fittest when we look upon it through the prism. when we look upon it through the prism of the Darwin, but it is what we call as differential reproduction when we analyze it through the modern synthetic theory. Now, the modern synthetic theory divides the natural selection into different types. There are many types of the natural selection. For example, there is stabilizing natural selection, and there is directional natural selection, and again there is diversifying natural selection, and then there is cyclic natural selection, and then there is OR and K selection. All these selections we will not discuss over here. I will attempt over here only three types of the natural selections. That is the what we call as the stabilizing natural selection, and then the directional natural selection, and lastly the diversifying natural selection. So what we mean by the stabilizing selection? Stabilizing selection believes that all those individuals which do have the mean phenotypes, they will be conserved in the populations, and all those genotypes, all those individuals which have the extreme genotypes, they will be eliminated or rooted out from the rooted out. So what does it mean? For example, we take the example of the human babies. The average weight of the human babies is something very much close to the 7.2 pounds. But we say that the normal reference range for the birth weight of the human babies, it varies from 5 to 10 pounds. Means if a baby is having a birth weight from 5 to 10 pounds, it is taken as normal. So all these babies which do have their birth weight in the range of 5 to 10 pounds, they have greater chances of what we call as survival, and they have very less chances of mortality. When we see those babies which do have a birth weight of less than 5 pounds or greater than 10 pounds, they have high mortality rates, means they have high death rates. So these human babies which do have birth rates, which do have the birth weight of less than 5 pounds or greater than 10 pounds, they can be taken as an example of extreme genotypes in the stabilizing natural selection, and they are eliminated. And those individuals or those human babies which do have their birth weight in the reference range of 5 to 10 pounds, they are taken as the mean genotypes, and they survive in the stabilizing natural selection. Then there is second type of the natural selection which we call as this directional natural selection. Directional natural selection is a type of natural selection in which we see that the individuals who survive or who are able to what we call as evolve in the direction in which the environment what we call as demands them to evolve, and these individuals are said to undergo directional selection. Means those individuals in which evolution occurs in a way in which the environment demands. If the evolution occurs in natural selection occurs in such a way that in which the environment demands, it is known as the directional natural selection. Again, over here, we can take the example of the DDT resistant or the pesticide resistant pests. We are seeing that we are using these pesticides from quite a long time, and all the pests used to die earlier when we used the pesticides, or they used to vanish after we apply, sorry, after we applied the pesticides upon them. But we are seeing that recently, we are seeing that there is a new tendency that is. The many of the pests have developed the pesticide resistance, and they have evolved in such a way that the pesticides fail to have their impact upon these very pests. So they have, if the pests have to survive, then they have to evolve in such a way so that the pesticides may not impact them. And we are seeing recently that some pests have evolved in this direction, although this very alarming situation. But we are saying that these pests have evolved in the direction in which the environment demanded them to evolve, and this type of the natural selection is what we call as the directional natural selection. Then there is another type of natural selection which we call as diversifying natural selection. This natural selection occurs in which what we see, the extreme phenotypes are conserved or they are selected, whereas the mean phenotypes are eliminated. So in this way, it is opposite to that of the stabilizing natural selection, in which we earlier saw that the mean phenotypes are conserved, whereas the extreme phenotypes are eliminated. Again, we say that in diversifying natural selection, there is the condition that's opposite to that of the stabilizing natural selection, so that the average phenotypes are conserved, whereas the mean phenotypes are eliminated. Over here, we can make it clear by taking the example of a bird that's African fire-bellied seed cracker. When we see this this seed cracker, we see that these seed crackers usually have three types of beaks. One type of the seed cracker is having very long beak, and another type of seed cracker is having very short beak, whereas there also exist seed crackers which have a beak of medium size. So this medium sized beak possessing seed cracker, it's a average phenotype or it's a mean phenotype, whereas on either side of the average or mean phenotype, there lie extreme phenotypes having very large sized beaks and very small sized beaks. So in this type of diversifying natural selection, the extreme phenotypes are eliminated, like the these large sized beak possessing seed crackers and small beak sized what we call as possessing seed crackers, beak possessing seed crackers, they are fixed or they are conserved. So the extreme phenotypes are conserved, whereas the mean phenotype is eliminated. And again, we say that it is opposed to that of the stabilizing natural selection. This is how it goes on. That's how diversifying natural selection is. I hope that you have understood what's natural selection and how the definitions and the concepts of the natural selection varied from that of the Darwin to the modern synthetic theory, and what are the main types of the natural selection. I will again repeat that all the types of the natural selection I didn't discuss over here. I discussed only three types of the natural selection. Rest are cyclic natural selection, R and K selection, and others. Hope that you have understood natural selection, what Darwin believed and what modern synthetic theory proponents believed about the natural selection. Again, I will try to make you understand over here that it is very important when you study evolution at any level, either you study it at senior secondary level, or you study it at a graduate level or at postgraduate level, you have to make in-depth study of evolution. As has been said by a prominent evolutionist, Dobbs Hensky, that nothing in biology makes sense except in the light of evolution. So if you do not understand evolution, I'm saying about all the students of biology, if you do not understand evolution, it's impossible for you people to understand the biology. You can remember the concepts, you can remember the things about the biology, but you cannot clearly justify the concepts of the biology. So, but when we discuss about the evolution, we have to look at the evolution through two different angles. That's through the angle of the classical evolution, evolutionary biology, and the modern evolutionary biology. By classical evolutionary biology, I mean what Darwin believed about, And by modern evolutionary biology, I mean what modern synthetic proponents or what modern synthetic theory proponents believed in. Hope that you have understood what is natural selection. And for other videos, you can subscribe your own channel. That's Mudabir's Biology Color. Thank you.